So we could make it very simple, you know, how this... So how fit are you guys? How fit are you? Are you fit? Dead, cold, empty? Look, we could make it very simple, this lecture, yeah, very simple, because this lecture could be done by just showing you a video. Okay?
Should we do that?
Yeah. Okay.
You know it?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know the video? Who doesn't know the video? Huh? You don't know? Who doesn't know the video? So, are you ready for just making a 15-minute little lean backwards?
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh? Should we do that? Okay. Now, the only thing I tell you why I think the video says more than the rest is just as an introduction. So the book of this Benham, just as an idea, is that the guy you will see, he's an historian, yeah? And usually he would not be someone who could say something about urbanism, but what is the unique thing of this situation is he was the first guy, basically, as you can see, who came as a European towards the US and wanted to understand what's the modern city look like, yeah? And of course, what his problem was, as a stupid European historian, you know, only knowing historical buildings, blah, 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 he realized that he has no vocabulary of understanding the contemporary city. Because you will see, Los Angeles, yeah, was 100 years, or let's say 120 years ago, a ranger village, a pampas, you know, here, and it was like nothing. Yeah. So, why the U.S. became interested? Because the U.S. was the first time that you could experience a city that had no historical reference and was just built in the idea of modernism. And as you can see, the reason why I'm saying that Randall Panham is a modernist, because does anyone know a book about him? Anyone ever heard about the guy? Yeah. Because he basically became a historian about the modern industrialization, or as you know, some of his books is called Architecture in the First Machine Age, and Architecture, I think, in the Second Machine Age, or something like this. Yeah? Now, two things he became very famous for. He became basically the architect who, or the historian who wrote about what you could call the well-tempered environment. So he became fascinated by the idea of air conditioning. So he became fascinated about everything that was a modern intervention, yeah, that drove new forms of architecture in the city. Yeah? So imagine when he was interested in the air conditioning, then he was interested in the go to LA. Why? Mademoiselle from Greece. Because what was American innovation, the urbanism based on which kind of innovation? He didn't go to Manhattan, because in Manhattan he would be fascinated in the innovation of?
Skyscraper?
Not the skyscraper, the elevator. Because for him, the elevator is a consequence, the high rise is a consequence of the elevator, like, and you will see, like for Rem Koolhaas. Huh? So why does he go to LA? Huh? Very simple. Of course, it's very nice room, you know. He went there, just lying on the beach, you know, yeah, and saying, oh, why don't we have some Greek sand, you know? I don't like Italian. So why did he go to the U.S.? Around 1900, I'll go in the city. What modern innovation has constructed L.A.? Not the high, not the elevator. Not the air conditioning, the car. So you have to imagine there comes this European professor from Cambridge just biking, you know, his home, and suddenly he has to discover LA, and what has he have to do? What do you have to do? He had to learn how to drive a car. So in the whole story, and this is, I think, the funny story why the video is there, because after he made his research, he made the video, yeah, of driving around in LA in the 1970s, and just for knowing, I'm just to give you an idea how that city looked like, I think it's interesting. Now, my question to you is, now why did he use a new word? I mean, why did he not say Los Angeles, the architecture of the car? What do you think? My thing is, if an historian would go into the city of a European city or whatever, probably to any kind of city in history, he would look into a layers of history. Oh, look at Rome, you know, little Pantheon building 1000, little Basilicum 1000. Yeah, he would look at it as a kind of layering of architecture. Yeah? Well, there's a Germany, there are historians who say, no, the only truth to architecture is to measure, you know. They would measure building. Yeah? And there are people who say, no, look, I see a material composite, you know, which is already a means of production that the Greeks found out, you know, the Romans found out how to make concrete, and I found this composite, but the Middle Ages forgot it, so that's why they started to build, you know, in bricks again, probably. So there is a material history, there is a measurement history, but the point is, he had no bloody idea what kind of history he should apply onto LA, because there was no history. So what he did now is, he was interested in the idea, can I translate a term that actually is used in biology, meaning, can I understand, I think, because if you look into biology, ecology means how do you understand the environment of either a species or a human subject, meaning what's basically my environment, what is me constituted by an environment, yeah? And he translates that into architecture and says, can I look into the architecture that is constituted by an environment in which it is embedded? Yeah? So instead of knowing what the architecture looks like, can I look into the environment that tells me something about the kind of architecture? And what he was now fascinating in is that he actually said the city constitutes out of four ecologies. Now these four ecologies, in my terms, I don't know if you ever talked about this, are actually what he would call the four ideas of what you could call, I don't want to say public space, but what you could call as the communal space, in a way, in which the city lives as a public. And he was interested in what kind of architecture reemerged by this. Yeah? And does anyone can tell me a kind of architecture that reemerged from LA, that only exists in LA? One that you've nearly seen every kind of movie. If you have a car, okay? You have a car. And then you have a function. Call it bank. What do you think how it looks like? Well, you could say, I have a car, step out, go in a parking lot, and go then in the bank. But what is an LA like bank? It's a drive-in bank. So just so you understand, what you have to imagine now is, and this is what he became fascinated in, is are there new kind of programs emerging that happens through the car that is unrelated to what Europeans or probably others might like to walk nicely in the Middle Ages by a pedestrian, yeah? And so, just to know, the whole movie that he is going to be is about finding this kind of architecture, and so there are different kind of churches, different kind of parties. So basically, one of the nicest scenes in the movie is actually one of the one of the 60s artists. You will find him, Ed Ruscio, who in principle was photographing in that time that the public space in the US, in LA, is not the concert hall, but actually the petrol station.
Yeah.
And the petrol station is not just for tanking, it's there where you meet people.
Yeah.
And I can only recommend you, if you once go to an LA, you will realize that in basic, how you actually move around is not because you navigate from, like Europeans would say, from the church to the next place and so on, but you go by destination to singularities. Now, why this is might be totally strange to you, but you won't believe that when he described the city, and Aldo Rossi, the guy before, yeah, who described only the European city, went to the US, he actually realized that his thesis of the city is actually the thesis, is actually the lived US city. Because as you remember, what Aldo Rossi was interested in is, these are the singularities of monuments, this is the urban fabric, yeah? And in principle, LA is not something different, yeah? Is you have a grid, and in this grid are just a bunch of singular buildings, and what you do is you go from destination to destination to destination to destination. That's why it doesn't matter where you are, as long as you can find it on a app. So just to know, you will see in that movie that it's a city also in which you behave differently. It has no reference to all of this, yeah? And just as a little summary, these are the four ecologies that he's going to look at. One is about suburbia. This is the kind of the whole beach stuff, yeah? Which shows that what kind of architecture comes out from the beach. The next ecology is interested is, if you know LA, it has a flat plain and then it has the hills, yeah? And there where the hills is basically touching the plains, yeah? There is a kind of architecture emerging in the foothills. Then you have the planes of ID, that's in principle, or of the it, that's in principle this gigantic grid between downtown and Santa Monica. And then the Autopia is in principle the highway network that is floating above, okay? So just as a definition, this is the idea of ecology, which comes from the Greek house, or oikos, yeah, or the study of. And in a kind of scientific term, or this is the way that I use it by Ernst Haeckel, you know, a biologist from the 19th century, you could say it's the relationship of a living organism with respect to each other in their natural environment. Yeah? Okay? Now, so this is just for a little image. Here you should just know that this is going to be the coast, and just know, and this is where it all started, you know? So, did you know? 1845, it looked like a small little village, yeah? So let's see if of course, it's all a question if this internet is working. Hmm? But let's say, since we are totally up to date these days, yeah? Let's go and hammer into this video. Any questions? I think the thing, but I think what is interesting is this is, it's the first time that someone starts to study, and this is, I think, back to the idea of the whole lecture series that I wanted to give you, is when Rossi was already interested in the idea of typologies, then it was already the first idea, which I argued before, that the city is the producer of typologies, yeah? So, as you know, the whole lecture series is about what if the city becomes the author of architecture, yeah? So here you could say, in the second lecture, the author of architecture is the ecology of the city that in principle produces architecture. Huh? Clear? Yeah? If you are quiet, it mostly means that you didn't understand me, yeah? No? Or you're totally sleepy, yeah? So that's why we are going to fall asleep now, yeah? One moment. See, this is always interesting. There's this mouse. Ah, here it comes. Mm-hmm. See, it went out there, drove around, you know, I made a topological transformation into the into the Mark Wigley's infrastructure, yeah, through the cable
in here, yeah,
around the world, shortly up into the internet outside, you know, yeah, you know, loaded with some like electricity shocks, you know, going from 120 to 220, you know, freaking out, you know, and going back into the pixel here, into here, yeah. Yeah, this is how the world looks like, my friends. Don't worry. One day before yesterday, my country would have turned into the worstest country of the planet. Today, it's the best one. So just know, if you want to be a good Austrian, you know, you just turn around, you know? But don't worry about Austria, it can always turn back. Yeah? So, who cares? I got letters, you know? But just know, the world only recognizes bad news, never good news, yeah? So, okay. So, let me see if that show starts. Now, let's see if it's working. Of course it's not. Okay, stop. Let's get rid of this kind of arrange mirror. Okay, now I of course have no sound, yeah? So what we're going to do is this. Let's see. Oh. Now the music is bad. Okay, you see already? So 1972. Now I have to tell you honestly, this is what I really liked recently. If you want to meet a country that got stuck in the 70s, you know? Yeah? You have to go to Iran. Oh, sorry. No, but it's really beautiful. I mean, I think it's really beautiful. It's really beautiful, yeah? If you still can find environments, yeah? That basically sort of throws you back, you know? Or yeah? Yeah. So I think it's nice to be thrown back into LA. At least, not the people in Iran, but the car driving, you know? Yeah? Okay, guys, let's see.
That's Los Angeles. You can always recognize it by these. And that's me, Rainer Baron, crossing the road. I'm professor of the history of architecture at University College London. You might wonder what I'm doing in Los Angeles, which makes nonsense of history and breaks all the rules. Well, I love the place with a passion that goes beyond sense or reason.
Just no, I'm not going to tell you what it meant to be in LA in 1972. Yeah, I mean, I just know some of the people didn't survive, and you should see some. Documentaries about David Bowie, yeah, and people that moved into LA, you know, in the 70s, yeah, was interesting.
I come here as often as I can, but this time there's an added attraction.
Welcome to Los Angeles, super city of the future, the metropolis of Southern California. Of discriminating visitors, this car has been equipped with the Beta Car Visitor Guidance System, courtesy of Pennywise Car Rentals and Sunset Gasoline. The clean gasoline.
Helps my soul.
Now you're ready to go. Begin by following the signs for Century Boulevard so that you can concentrate fully on your driving. Switch off the guidance system when you hear the tone. Have a nice day, and here comes the switch-off tone.
Baedeker is a fiction, a joke tribute to Karl Baedeker, the father of the modern guidebook. A useful fiction. Devising a guide is a good way to explain a city, and Los Angeles needs some explaining, because it's normally regarded as an unspeakable sprawling mess, though not, certainly not by me. So, where shall we send our visitor first? Soon Century Boulevard will link up with the freeway system, and some lightning decisions will have to be made, because the freeways are unforgiving. Shall we go 20 miles north to the beach cities for sun and fun and surf? Shall we go 20 miles northeast to you know where? Could we go 15 miles south to the cliffs of Palos Verdes Mountain? And the suburbia on top of it? Or would we better go 20 miles southeast to Long Beach and the poor old Queen Mary in retirement? And that ridiculous island with its beautified oil rigs? Or why don't we go 15 miles eastwards to downtown, where they actually have ancient monuments, like the old Pico building? And the Plaza Church, the traditional center of Los Angeles since the days this was part of Mexico. In fact, in this fairly normal type of tourist area, with a bit of history about it, you can actually walk about like a conventional tourist with a guidebook in your hand. Here, a visitor could get along without Baedeker. A conventional enough tourist trap, an expensive flea market that you could find in any big city in the world. But outside here, in the Los Angeles beyond Olvera Street, is a city that is nothing like any other. Los Angeles is certainly unlike the London where I usually live and move and have my being. And it's as remote as Mars from Norwich, the city where I was born and brought up. You remember Norwich? That fine city in all the insurance calendars? It's your British standard cathedral city, with its cathedral in whose shadow I played manly sports, its marketplace and its castle, those surviving medieval walls and narrow cobble streets, and the handsome houses with their Georgian porches. But Norwich isn't all history and glamour. I went to school in Nelson Street, bylaw housing and a red brick Victorian school, all run down and partly destroyed now. It stirs no nostalgia to go back there. The back in the next street, there was an entrance where we queued up on Saturday mornings, waiting to get into a hall that has been many things, but in those days it was the Penny Pictures. And there, when we had the penny for admission, we were transported to Los Angeles. Because all those marvelous old Hollywood silence were made on location as Los Angeles was being built. I knew Los Angeles long before I got there. From Buster Keaton to Perry Mason and beyond, we're all familiar with the place already. Well, it's familiar in a way, but when you're there in the traffic on Century Boulevard, it can be pretty strange and nervous. On either side of you are streams of determined drivers. They know where they're going. But where are you going? Already you've gone under the San Diego freeway, and you're right in the middle of it. I wonder if Beta Car could have the guts to throw you in at the deep end like this.
We really ought to level with you. This guided tour isn't taking you to any of the tourist spots you might expect. Right now, you're entering Watts. Because we believe that the discriminating visitor will want to see what the city of the future is doing to cure the evils of the past. As you look around, you could hardly believe it was the center of the worst race riots in the history of California. Since 1965, the local community and the city of Los Angeles have inaugurated a program to rebuild the Watts District, and you will see the results as you drive along. If you turn right at the junction of Century and the street that bears the hopeful name of Success, you will find that you are entering the Watts Redevelopment Project. One block down Success will bring you to 103rd Street, the focus of the riots. Make a left on 103rd and you're on Charcoal Alley. It may not be good looking, but you should have seen it after the riots. And before the riots. Watts was never all problems. There are some beautiful things here, too. As soon as you cross the railroad tracks, watch out for a right turn on Graham Avenue. Around you go then, down the side of the tracks, and then narrow little 107th Street comes up on the left. At the end of that street, you'll surely see why we brought you this way. These are the famous Watts Towers, a do-it-yourself monument to man's craving for beauty, executed over a period of 33 years by Simon Rodia, an untutored genius from Rome, Italy. Enjoy your visit now. Switch off when you hear the tone.
Any visitor here myself, too, and before I showed him anything else, usually. But wherever we went first, Watts or not, the journey would be the problem. This is a huge city, 70 miles square. It's a long way from anything to anything. And when you get to it, your destination may not be a clearly defined location. And the means of getting there may look pretty alarming. 15 to 30 minutes high-speed driving on the freeways, which I personally find rewarding. You see,
I think freeway driving is interesting in itself. From up here, you see the most weird, extraordinary places and things which you can hardly see from down below. But you have to, you know, discover them for yourself, because you read about them in the guidebook, you'd have forgotten about them by the time you got there. And I honestly don't know how helpful the gentle voice of Baedeker would be. It could really be a distraction under these kind of conditions.
Up now on your right is the world's biggest toy and game factory. From here, Matt Mason's space toys, Hot Wheels cars, and Barbie dolls go to all parts of the free world.
I'd say, Barbie dolls, for God's sake, and look round for a better look, and sort of drift over in the next lane and prank some little old lady from Pasadena in her boss Mustang, and bash, that'd be the end of a beautiful guided tour.
But driving the freeways is an experience in itself. How about a spot of motorized art appreciation?
Hello again. Ahead of you right now is the intersection of the Santa Monica and San Diego freeways. It's reckoned by experts to be the most elegant in the world. Get in the lane marked Santa Monica, but watch out for traffic. And remember that flashing a signal does not constitute any right of way. For Santa Monica, and soon you'll be making a long, smooth sweep over the high, curving ramp against the sky. How about that? Isn't it the only way to go? Back to Earth again. Watch out for the signs for Bundy Drive South. Repeat, south. If you don't do this right, we'll never get you back on course. Then switch off until you've gone under the freeway.
And if you did get it all right, and really did get a kick out of it, then you'd be ready to enjoy anything at all in Los Angeles. So how about starting with something completely obvious? Griffith Park Observatory, one of the classic viewpoints for observing the city. But it's more than that. It's a familiar and beloved landmark to every citizen of the place, and to every persistent moviegoer as well. Remember Rebel Without a Cause and James Dean? Here you have this fantastic view of the whole enormous city of Los Angeles. On a clear day, endless streets running away for miles and miles and miles to what looks like just plain, endless, boring American suburbia. But when you look into it more closely, then you realize it's really a very different kind of place. Into the layout of the city, the more you see that it consists increasingly of long lines of tall business towers threaded through a sea of little houses. The classic is Wilshire Boulevard, where only a line of parking lots separates the business street from the residential suburbia immediately behind it. So, something like a million Angelenos could say something you'd never expect to hear them say. I live within walking distance of my work. Strangely, you have to explain this to Angelenos, as I often find myself doing at University of Southern California.
In terms of form, Los Angeles breaks all the rules which have been deduced by town planners over the years from the rules deduced from existing cities like London, like Paris, like Moscow, or wherever. It breaks all those rules, and yet I would maintain it is still, in spite of that, a great city and a significant city. Because I think that the form matters very little, and that you can build a city any shape you like as long as it works. And you say, works? Los Angeles works? Everyone tells you that it doesn't work. From the ecological point of view, we are told, and on very good authority, that there's much too much pollution. but I can think of much dirtier cities. Heaven knows, much dirtier cities than Los Angeles. So, come the day when the smog doom finally descends, when the traffic grinds to a halt and the private car is banned from the streets, quite a lot of craftily placed citizens will be able to switch over to being pedestrians and feel no pain.
On a clear day, rise and look around you, and you'll see. Every star, you'll feel part of every mountain, sea, and shore, and you'll hear from far and near a world you've never ever heard before. And on that clear day, you can see for.
Lots of the text of Baedeker exist already, thanks to the bus tours. Let's hear what he has to say about this part of Wilshire Boulevard.
Very beautiful shops up ahead of us on the Maritime Mile. Right underneath us is one of the largest pools or deposits of oil in the whole Los Angeles area.
Float on oil it may do, but in town planning terms, it floats on single-family dwellings, business islands in a sea of domesticity. To look at all this from up here, you may not see much affinity between this ocean of houses and a city like London, yet the building history is really very similar. The famous Georgian squares are the true prototype for Los Angeles. Residential in intention, they were created by the breakup of big landed estates, like every suburban subdivision in Los Angeles. They were broken up for profitable investment, ditto in Los Angeles. And in both places, the houses were as thinly spread as possible. In 18th century London, that wasn't very thin. The houses stand shoulder to shoulder because everything moved on foot, and distances measured in living feet have to be short. Bloomsbury ended on a precise line, representing the furthest point the citizens were prepared to walk. In Los Angeles, the citizens had wheels and could travel further. Not originally the wheels of automobiles, but the wheels of the Pacific Electric Railroad and the streetcars that rattle through all those early silent comedies. Pacific Electric is gone now. It finally died only a decade ago. But you can still find among the undergrowth the rusting rails that once tied the whole huge city together. So, in a city of good communications and apparently unlimited space, the citizens could gratify their obsession with single-family dwellings in their own gardens. Remember how in Watts there were no multi-story tenements. Even ghetto people have nice little houses. But what can Baedeker do about the city's obsession with private houses set in their own grounds? Send the visitor to gawp at a panorama of exteriors like the bus tours of film star homes.
Lake storefront, Cross River Band. And the next home on your left, sold 2 years ago, was sold by Mary Livingston and Jack Benny. It was their former home. They sold it to Rosalind Russell, and the home sold for $280,000, and it's now the home of Rosalind Russell.
You know how much it is worth today? You know, I mean, some of these things you don't get under 10 to 20 million.
To your right, the home of Mr. and Mrs. Harry Carl, you know her as Debbie Reynolds. And back on your left-hand corner, one of the wealthiest ladies in Beverly Hills, and a very smart businesswoman, as well as a fine actress, Miss Lucille Ball's home. course, this yarn is used to liquor, too.
Never mind the film stars and their private palaces. Lots of ordinary people came here and built unpretentious homes combining domesticity with the fantasy of their dreams. Quite a lot of this good domestic architecture is in the style you can see here, if style you can call it. It's called Spanish colonial sometimes, or the mission style. You recognize it by its white walls, its arches, its wooden columns, and by these roofs of heavily twisted tiles. But I don't know whether it's really a style or whether it's really a frame of mind, whether it isn't a special kind of Los Angeles mass-produced fantasy for people to live in. Dreams, domestic dreams that money can buy, but dreams like the dreams of Hollywood. This always bring out the Hollywood private eye in me. Domestic design is the California bungalow, which has now been exported all over the world. And this is the greatest of them all, the Gamble House in Pasadena. Is that I'm privileged to live in this house as a visiting professor at the university. And it really is a privilege. It's a great house. But it was built originally for a Gamble family by the local architects, Charles and Henry Green, finished in 1910. The Gambles lived in it until really quite recently when it was handed over to the university and the city of Pasadena. And here I live. And you live comfortably here. I mean, it's a big, showy house for a winter cottage, goodness knows. But and it has these great, generous spaces inside and all this wooden craftsmanship and stuff. But you can live comfortably here. It's a very, very romantic house, but it's also a really domestic one. Great talents like Frank Lloyd Wright built houses in Los Angeles. That's his Ennis House, and this is the Health House by Richard Neutra, one of the most advanced in the world in 1930. And here, over the ocean in Pacific Palisades, is the house that really taught the world's architecture lovers to come to Los Angeles. The house that Charles Eames, the great chair designer and filmmaker, created in 1949 and showed the world that machine-age materials like glass and steel could be beautiful, even pretty, and make a proper setting for beautiful objects. Thank you.
The Eames House is private. Nearly all the good architecture is private. And this expands into a major problem for the tourist.
Palos Verdes Mountain, with its tree-shaded streets, is one of the most exclusive residential areas in all of Los Angeles. Its layout is a veritable labyrinth of picturesque mountainside drives, and it's very easy to get lost. So have a map handy. Not all of the roads marked on the map are open to the public, so you should watch out for warning signs or flashing lights at the guard posts around the city of Rolling Hills.
Can I get through to San Pedro this way?
No, sir, you cannot.
Well, there's a road on the map.
Yeah, but this is a private road. You can't get through here.
I didn't know there were any private roads.
This is the city. They got a guard at every gate. They have guards here 24 hours a day at four different gates, 8-hour shifts.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Now, how do you live there? How do you get in?
Well, you got a sticker. If a resident, or if you have somebody's business, just to go through, I can't let you through.
I have a passport.
You have to turn around and go back to Crenshaw. Other way to get San Pedro. I'm sorry, but that's the way it is.
Okay.
That's my job.
Uh-huh.
Cities you can't get into. You know, when you have a place like this, which is a sort of good imitation of a terrestrial paradise and the appearance of a free society, and then you have guarded gates and so on. It's like the Balkans before 1914.
Rolling Hills is a little defensive kingdom that keeps strangers out. But Los Angeles has really wide open communities as well. This is Venice Beach, where all sorts and conditions of Angelenos have come to find themselves and make a way of life. Of course, it wasn't built as a communal crash pad. It started life as a romantic suburb like any other. Abbot Kinney, its founder, wanted to create a replica of the other Venice, and some of it got built. Then they struck oil. After that came the Depression. Still, he made his canals, and his Venetian bridges still survive. Nowadays, people come here when they drop out, give up, or just change their minds. It's a relaxed sort of community, but it could be a violent one as well. It's a melting pot, socially unstable. It makes staid citizens and businessmen nervous. And the police. But there are gentle people here as well. The fine art squad, working out fantasies like Venice in the snow on the walls of buildings. And there are muscle artists working out fantasies on their own bodies.
Yeah, I train every day, 6 days a week, about an hour and a half a day. And we break it up into different muscle groups, like chest one day, I work the back one day, shoulders one day, arms one day. Just so it works in a cycle, so that you work each muscle every 2 or 3 days, and it keeps you physically fit. Then you follow a good diet, such as lean meats, eggs, cottage cheese, salads, fruits, and eliminate the carbohydrates and starches, which it all works hand in hand for a healthy body and healthy mind. This is nice. It could be improved, I think, and they're cleaning it up slowly, and probably in the next 5 to 10 years it'll be a very nice area to live. It's improved a lot in the past couple of years, I think. It can improve a lot more. There's a lot of nice people around here. Everybody knows everybody. It's very easy to make friends. Everybody has the same common interests of weight training and physical fitness. And it's the biggest thing now is coming up, all the health food stores and health foods fads. So it's a common interest among many people, and it keeps peace.
I think Venice might be the point where I could actually disagree with Baedeker.
The new municipal municipal auditorium with its handsomely planted park is the beginning of an urban renewal program that will transform Venice. Traditionally, it has been a home for artists and writers, and many of their picturesque homes will surely survive. But the dropouts and problem people who have moved into the area in recent years have made a cleanup necessary.
Yes, but where could all those people go?
What the future holds for Venice, as the dirty abandoned canals are cleaned up, will probably look something like the spanking new yacht harbor of Marina del Rey.
Ugh, another executive ghetto, plastic people in plastic boats.
Along the ocean front with its magnificent beaches, derelict old Pacific Ocean Park Pier will be replaced by a new apartment venture right over the surf.
Hey, hold it. That's heresy. This was the greatest pleasure pier in the world. I have picture postcards to prove it. And it wasn't derelict. It was deliberately bankrupted to make a real estate bonanza.
New developments will surely follow as Angelenos rediscover the pleasures of living right on the ocean or along the romantic old canal. To get the flavor of these possibilities, we suggest that before going north to Malibu, you visit the new marina and see for yourself the attractions of waterside living.
No, thank you. You go to Malibu. With something much more interesting right here in Venice, in a big tin shed about 10 blocks away. It's not a factory. It's the studio of Vasa Mihalic, a Yugoslav sculptor now settled in Venice, where a number of artists have discovered that a big old shed is a good place to work. Out of this workshop come some of the most beautiful abstract sculptures I've ever seen. Sort of craftsmanship that goes with power tools, advanced plastics, and space age chemistry. A sort of craftsmanship that now seems native to Los Angeles. Those transparent columns of yours are really fantastic. Now, could you have done this outside Los Angeles?
I hope so, not. But I think it's very convenient to do them here.
Why? Because the technology is.
Yeah, everybody thinks it's technology. Mm. And maybe I'm wrong, but I think it's a town. See, in this town, you really feel, at least me being European by background, you feel kind of like a free, you know. Mm-hmm. You can do crazy things and get away with it. You even can find some crazy people which you buy this to.
I mean, there are people here mad enough.
Yeah, you will find this, you know. And yeah. This kind of freedom, let's put it this way, artistic freedom,
yeah.
To be specific, you just find here. Mm-hmm. It's a light, it's a people, it's a space, it's a wild town, I just feel here kind of like a fish in the water. I mean, I'm not afraid of anything.
Other feeling in the world that compares with taking off on a clean 7-foot wave, crouching down, feeling the force of the wave just spraying your back as you come firing out. It's just the greatest thing in the world. I wouldn't trade it for anything. I've lived in Hermosa Beach all my life. Hermosa has been known as kind of the surfing capital of the world because all the main manufacturers are in Hermosa Beach.
Garza's assistant used to work in a surfboard factory like this. The new craftsman moved between art and industry in a real Freemasonry of talent. What holds the whole thing together, artists, craftsmen, and sportsmen, is a common admiration for high finish and high style. Just look at the paintwork on these vans. And you can do wild things inside vans. Like play the piano, yeah. Wherever I am, I'll come running, yeah, yeah, to see you again.
Into spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there, yes, I will.
Inside and out, vans get this loving attention because they're the new thing in California, a new mobile private lifestyle. And if you don't believe me, listen to Brad, the mobile musician.
Well, I find that at this particular point in my life, living alone and living very independently is really very comfortable. It's very happy. I spent 3 years prior to getting this van, I was living in a house with a lot of people. It was a commune, and it was great, and I really enjoyed it at that particular point in my life. And I got to the point where I really wanted to play the piano a lot. I just wanted to play all the time and sing and make a whole lot of racket. And I found that you couldn't do it at a house like that. Other people wanted to play. Other people wanted to play the record player. Other people wanted to sleep, whatever it was. So I couldn't do what I wanted to do. So I just decided I need a place that's really private where no matter how loud I yell, I'm not going to bother anybody. And even a private apartment doesn't provide that because you've got the people all around you, you know. So I just decided this is where it's at. I'll just stick it in the van, and I can take it where I want to, be close to nature when I want to, and make as much noise as I want to when I want to. So it's an extremely private life if I want it to be.
Our next stop is at the Grauman's Chinese Theater. The theater was opened on May 18th of 1927. Just prior to the opening of the theater, Mr. Grauman, accompanied by Mary Pickford and Douglas Fairbanks Sr., drove up in front of the theater to view the construction. And that morning they had placed a sidewalk there in front of the theater, and when they stepped out of their limousine, they stepped right into wet cement, and that's the way they got the idea for the hand and footprints.
Hooray for Hollywood!
Screen and the long playing record is the medium that has transmitted all that Los Angeles high style to the world.
A truly great city also offers a man a mechanism for imposing his own style and his own vision on the rest of the world. It was for this kind of thing that the young William Shakespeare came to London. Came to London already choking in a pall of coal smog, already riddled with VD and violence, a rotten city in many ways, but the only place where a young dramatist could make it and get his style through to a larger public at that time. It was for this kind of reason that generations of painters were prepared to starve romantically in the garrets of Paris. It takes a city to support style and craft. But it takes a very great city indeed to impose that kind of style on the rest of the world. And from the Hollywood movies to pop art to custom car painting to the design of surfboards and so on, Los Angeles has done just that.
Right then. A city whose public buildings aren't very good, whose good architecture is rather private, and its other goodies either mobile or being used by somebody at the time. What on earth should the visitor go to see? I called a meeting in Tiny Naylor's drive-in restaurant on Sunset Boulevard and put the question to two of the local talent, Ed Ruscha, painter and photographer of the scene, and Mike Salisbury, art editor of West magazine, the local colour supplement.
I can help you.
Right. Thank you. Can I just have a pineapple sundae?
BLT.
Okay. That the off?
Yep. She's really good. Well, she sure is.
Yeah, for real.
Thank you. Someone passing my sundae.
I think it's going to take three hands here.
And a spoon. And with luck, we're away.
One spoon for you.
Right, thank you.
Yeah, maybe a straw. Get a straw.
Now, when you're ready, our problem is this, that we're talking about a town that has no public monuments that are worth visiting. But there are plenty of public commercial buildings here that we could send the visitor to see. Now, what sort of public commercial vehicle should we send people to see? Mike?
Well, this one's really a good one, I think, because it's not only the last of the drive-ins, it's probably one of the best.
It's the drive-in to end all drive-ins.
Right.
Ed? What should people see?
Maybe gas stations, maybe.
Just gas stations.
Well, any kind of edifice that has to do with the car.
Mm-hmm.
And a gas station is one of them.
Yeah, but what are the particular virtues of these buildings?
Well, I like the fact that they can just put them together in about 3 days,
mm-hmm.
You know, or less.
And not
sometimes it takes longer to tear down an old building than it does to put up the new one.
Right.
And they're streamlined. Everything about it is streamlined. That's what I like.
And is the standardization a virtue?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely. I like the fact that they can just put something up and get right to business. And you know that they don't want to lose any time.
Yeah, but from the observer visitor's point of view, it means you can visit the same building in 900 different locations.
Yeah, but you're not sure it'll still be in the same location when you come back again next year.
But, I mean, drive-ins and things aren't standardized like that.
This isn't. But what's happening is they're being replaced either by gas stations, which are, or a new kind of restaurant, which used to be only in other parts of the country where they couldn't afford to do this, and now they can't afford to do this anymore.
You think the fantasy has gone out of it?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. And maybe there's a sort of tradition of fantasy in these kind of places locally, isn't there?
Well, there is. That's why they were, the whole reason they were created. I mean, people really believe the California kind of mystique.
That hot dog stand should look like hot dogs, eh?
Right.
The fantasy of these buildings that appeals to Mike Salisbury so much is an old established California fantasy, a belief that absolutely everything is possible, even a restaurant in the shape of a bowler hat. And the Brown Derby was built as far back as the early 20s.
Thank you.
filling stations, drive-ins, hot dog stands, car wash plants, yes to all those. But there are also complete districts that seem designed as drive-in scenes.
Sunset Strip, the section of Sunset Boulevard between Hollywood and Beverly Hills, is Entertainment Land West. During your stay, you'll probably want to visit the famous clubs, the Go-Go Girls, the topless shows, and the great rock music. You're here now, and almost certainly stuck in the traffic, or reduced to a walking pace. Look up at all those crazy advertising signs. Aren't they fantastic? They're like an outdoor art gallery. Tom Wolfe, the writer, called them electrographic architecture. People love them, and people hate them. But billboards, by day and night, are some of the greatest sights the city can show.
Sodom and Gomorrah, cried the preachers of ecological doom. Earthquake, fire, flood, and slow poisoning by smog perpetually threaten the city. There's a sense of impermanence about the whole place, and yet its threats are also, in many and strange ways, the making of its splendors.
And now, at the end of your sightseeing day, you are headed towards the ocean and one of the most famous and best-loved sights in all of Los Angeles, the sunset. View of the sunset is like a symbol for all the romantic aspirations of our city. We have named everything from bars to boulevards after it. God gave us the sun and the ocean, but the colors come mostly from the fumes and pollution that we ourselves pump into the atmosphere every day. Enjoy it. The best of it doesn't last long. And then drive safely to your motel. On behalf of Beta Car Visitor Guidance Systems, we would like to wish you good night and hope you will come visit with us again. Here comes the tone for the last time. Have a good evening.
Thank you, love. I couldn't have put it better myself. You know, that moment when it goes down beneath the Western Ocean, because you've got nowhere else to go. That great moment of plastic, fluorescent spectacle, sun going down in man-made splendor. That really is, to all us lovers of Los Angeles, the greatest exit line any city would ever have. Thank you.
Okay. I hope you got a sense of it. I mean, what probably not is explained all the way is just very simple, the idea that it became a place of another idea of metropolitan life, you know, even when it was a suburban city, but it became basically a city of an ecology of architecture. And I just wanted to show you that if you look now into how it also shaped the discourse, yeah, then you could say all these buildings like Lautner, you know, here, or I have some of them later on. For example, what no one knows, it also became the first shopping malls, you know. I don't know if you know this, but this is an Austrian guy who went there in the 50s and tried to bring the passage work, yeah, into, let's say, LA, and it made it suddenly a shopping mall. So the city became a constantly ecology of producing new kind of architecture, yeah. And why I'm saying this is because if you look not only to the historical stuff, yeah, but if you look, for example, the Schindler House, yeah, by Neutra, or for example, what is contemporary today, for example, no one knows that this was a Frank Gehry house in the 60s, yeah? So this was just one year after Gehry came to LA. And so this idea that it's a city that constantly reinvents and produces architecture is still happening today. And so, for example, here, if these were the famous case study houses, you know, then let's see if I have something. Do I have something in the end? No. Anyhow. Okay, guys. You know, I just wanted to show you this movie because I think in terms of the description that there is suddenly someone tries to define architecture as an ecology, you will see it's going to be different than we go later on to Las Vegas, because later when we are in Las Vegas, Venturi comes on with a semiological understanding. Yeah? But I think the interesting story of LA is in a certain way that that a city produces a culture, and with its environment produces a kind of new kind of architecture. It's a little bit of the day. It was the easiest one because I thought I'd show you a movie. But by that, we're going to see us, let's say, in, what was it? Monday in 1 week, yeah? And then we're going to have a regular lecture again. Until then, all the best, my friends.